द हैंड इज मेड अप ऑफ थ्री पार्ट्स. नंबर वन इज द रिस्ट और कार्पस, व्हिच इज मेड अप ऑफ एट कार्पल बोन्स. नेक्स्ट इज द हैंड प्रॉपर और मेटाकार्पस, मेड अप ऑफ फाइव मेटाकार्पल बोन्स नंबर्ड फ्रॉम लैटरल टू मीडियली. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. रिस्ट इज मेड अप ऑफ 8 कार्पल बोन्स. एंड द थर्ड पार्ट इज द डिजिट्स दैट इंक्लूड द थंब, इंडेक्स फिंगर, मिडिल फिंगर, रिंग फिंगर एंड द लिटिल फिंगर. And the bones of the digits are called the phalangeal bones. So that is the basic construction of the hand. Total number of phalangeal bone is 14. So if we add up all the bones of the hand, that will give a total of 14 plus 5 plus 8 equals to 27 bones. So you see, the hand is made up of 27 bones. That is a huge number that is accommodated in a very small area. Each upper limb contains a total of 32 bones. Out of the 32 bones, 27 bones are present in the hand alone. Now, I will describe the carpal bones and metacarpal bones and the phalanges briefly. Before going to that, let me tell you that the skeleton of the hand can be studied from both the palmar aspect. This is the palmar aspect. Palmar aspect means seen from the front. And it also can be viewed from the back, which is called the dorsal aspect. So from two sides we can study the skeleton of the hand. Next, move on to the individual sets of bones. First, about the carpal bones. As like the hand, the carpal bones can be studied from palmar aspect as well as from the dorsal aspect. This is the palmar side of the carpal bones and this is the dorsal side of the carpal bones. The carpal bones are 8 in number and these 8 carpal bones are arranged in 2 rows, proximal row and distal row. The proximal row is the row that is nearer to the body. So that is the proximal row. and the distal row of carpal bones. Are a bit away from the body. In the proximal row of carpal bone, there are four bones, and the distal row also comprises of four bones. Altogether, there are eight bones. Let us know the name of the bones of both proximal and distal row. First, for the proximal row, the nomenclature of the bone is usually said from the lateral to medial side. You know, the thumb is on the lateral side and the other side is the medial side. So the proximal row bones from the lateral to medial side are as follows. The most lateral one is the scaphoid, then lunate, then it is called the triquetral bone, triquetral T, and sitting on the triquetral is the pisiform. So once again, let's make it clear. The proximal row bones from lateral to medial are as follows. The lateral most bone is scaphoid. Next to the scaphoid is the lunate. Then there is the triquetral and sitting on the triquetral is the pisiform, scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, pisiform. The distal row of carpal bones also consist of four bones. Let's move on to the distal row. What are the four bones of the distal row? From lateral to medial, again, the distal row bones are trapezium, trapezoid, next capitate, and on the most medial side, number 4, hamate. Trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate from the lateral to medial side. So if we put the first alphabet of all the bones, then on the proximal row, these are the scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, pisiform, and in the distal row, these will be trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. Putting all the first alphabets together, a mnemonic has been devised that will help you to remember the names in the order. She looks too pretty. Try to catch her. Once again, she looks too pretty. Try to catch her. So that is the mnemonic. Okay. Now, the view that we have seen of the carpal bones is the palmar view. It is important to note that the pisiform bone can only be seen on the palmar view because pisiform is sitting on the triquetral. Pisiform is sitting on the triquetral on the palmar aspect. So if we see the carpal bones from the other side, that is from the dorsal aspect, we cannot see the pisiform. So on the palmar view or palmar aspect, pisiform is seen, not in the dorsal view. Let us see the dorsal view. This is the dorsal view. This is the lateral aspect. This is the medial side. On the dorsal aspect, from lateral to medial, we can see scaphoid, lunate, triquetrum. But pisiform is not clearly seen. A part of pisiform is actually peeping through. It is seen from the side, overlying the triquetrum bone from the palmar aspect. So pisiform is best seen from the palmar aspect. So part of pisiform is actually showing through. Then for the distal row, it is the trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, hamate. That is the dorsal view. One important thing is that all these carpal bones except the pisiform are short bones. The nature of carpal bones are short bones. And this type of classification of bone is done on the shape of the bones. In the body, we see long bone, short bone, flat bone, pneumatic, sesamoid, and accessory bones. So carpal bones, except the pisiform, are short bones. Where the pisiform, which is sitting on the triquetrum, it is a sesamoid bone. Sesamoid means the pisiform bone is formed within the tendon of a muscle, and that tendon is the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. So within the tendon of that muscle, the pisiform is generated. That's why it is a sesamoid bone. All the carpal bones are cartilaginous at birth, and each carpal bone ossifies from one center, and all the carpal bones ossify after birth. So at birth, there is no bone, there are cartilaginous structures, and later after birth, at different phase of life, they are gradually ossified. The first carpal bone that undergo ossification, it is the capitate. Which one? Capitate. Which one is the capitate bone? This is the capitate on the dorsal aspect, on the palmar aspect. Capitate. Capitate is the carpal bone that is the first carpal bone to ossify, as well as the largest carpal bone. and the first bone to ossify. First carpal bone to ossify. Okay. And the carpal bones which is last to ossify is the PC form. It is the last to ossify about the age of 12 years. So these are important features regarding the carpal bones. Now one important thing is that when we see the carpal bones on the cross section of hand, all the carpal bones together will present a ventral concavity. That is a ventral concavity. And dorsally, they produce a dorsal convexity. Okay, ventral concavity and dorsal convexity. There are two rows of carpal bones. So carpal bones cross section can be taken either at the level of proximal row or at the level of distal row. Okay. If the carpal bone cross section is taken at the proximal row, which bones we will see? We will see the scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, pisiform. So this cross section is taken at the level of the proximal row. CS at level of proximal row. Whether is the CS or cross section is taken at the level of distal row, we would have seen the other or distal row of bones, that is the trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. Whatever row is seen on cross section, all of them presents a ventral concavity and a dorsal convexity. Convex, concave. So that is the ventral concavity. Ventral concavity of the carpal bones. Coming to some important features of individual carpal bones. We'll take it one by one. For example, the scaphoid. Let's see the scaphoid. The scaphoid is a boat-shaped bone and it has a tubercle on distal part of its palmar surface. That is the tubercle of scaphoid. Similarly, the lunate has a moon-shaped structure and lunate is the most commonly dislocated carpal bone. Regarding the triquetral and pisiform, the pisiform bone sits over the triquetral on the palmar aspect. Coming to the trapezium, the trapezium has a crest and groove on its palmar surface. That is a crest of trapezium. Beneath the crest, there is a groove. So groove is covered by the bony projection that is called the crest of trapezium. Then we shift to the from the trapezoid capitate to the hamate. In the hamate bone, we get to see a hook-like process. This is called hook of hamate. Hook of hamate bone. So we have got the following important feature: tubercle of scaphoid, crest of trapezium, hook of hamate, and the pisiform bone, obviously on the palmar surface, sitting on the triquetral. So these are the important bony landmark. Regarding the scaphoid, let's talk about the scaphoid a bit. The scaphoid, which is a boat-shaped bone, this one, frequently undergoes fracture. And fracture of scaphoid is the most common fracture of the carpal bones and usually occurs due to the fall on the outstretched hand. The fracture line goes through the waist or middle part of the scaphoid. Now, blood vessels mostly enter the scaphoid through its both ends. So, both from the proximal end and from the distal end, usually blood vessel enter the scaphoid. But in 10 to 15% cases, what happens is that all the blood vessels supplying the proximal segment will enter it through its distal pole. This is the proximal pole and this is the distal pole of the scaphoid. Normally what happens? Blood vessel enter through both the poles. In some cases, blood vessels enter through the distal pole only and supply the proximal part of the bone. So in this condition, when the scaphoid is fractured in the waist, what will happen? Then the proximal part will be deprived of blood supply. Look, this is the scaphoid, proximal part, distal part. When the blood vessel is coming through the distal part up to the proximal part, if the fracture is occurring in the waist, waist means the middle part, waist of the scaphoid, obviously the proximal segment, this portion, proximal segment, will be devoid of blood supply because blood flow have been, the blood vessels have been ruptured along the midline, right? So only the distal segment have now uninterrupted blood flow, but the proximal segment, this one, is devoid of blood flow, because blood only flows up to this point uninterruptedly, and thereafter the blood flow or the blood vessels are cut. due to the fracture of the bone. See what happens when the fracture occurs. The blood vessels are uninterrupted up to this part, distal part. So the distal segment will get the blood supply. Distal segment. But in case of proximal segment, the blood vessels are no longer getting the flow from their source. So the proximal segment will be devoid of blood flow. And there will be avascular necrosis. Okay. So fractured scaphoid may result in avascular necrosis of the proximal segment. Not all the time, but in some cases. Now we shift to the metacarpal bones. Metacarpal bones are 5 in number, I have already told you, and they are conventionally numbered from lateral to medial side. Each metacarpal is a miniature long bone. I have told you the carpal bones are short bones and metacarpals are miniature long bones consisting of three parts: head, base, and in between them, shaft. Head is at the distal end, base is at the proximal end, and in between them is the shaft. Of the five metacarpal bones, the first metacarpal has some peculiarities. Now, before going to that, let me tell you that each metacarpal ossifies from two centers. Each carpal bone ossifies from only one center. Carpal bones, one center of ossification. But metacarpal bone has got two centers of ossification. One is the primary center of ossification. Primary center means from where the bone is formed before birth. And the primary center of ossification is present in the shaft of the metacarpals. That is the primary. From the primary center of ossification, the shaft of the metacarpals are usually formed. And there is another center of ossification that is called secondary center of ossification. Which appear after birth. So the part of the bone that are ossified from the secondary center of ossification develop after birth. In the medial four metacarpals, in metacarpal 2, 3, 4 and 5, the secondary center are located in the head. Whereas in case of first metacarpal, the secondary center is at the base instead of at the head. So that is one peculiarity. So let's just revise. What is the primary center? The center which appeared before birth. Before birth. So bone that ossify from primary center, they form before birth, and secondary center, they appear after birth. So bones that are coming from the secondary ossification, they grow after the birth. So the secondary center ossification in case of first metacarpal is located at the base. That is the first important peculiarity of first metacarpal. Next is that the first metacarpal is the shortest of the five metacarpal and stoutest of the five metacarpals, and it is usually rotated medially through 90 degrees, so that the dorsal surface is facing laterally. What is that? In case of the other metacarpals, we are seeing two aspects. From the dorsal side, if we see the dorsal view, this is the dorsal aspect of the shaft. Okay, dorsal aspect of the shaft. Now, in case of the first metacarpal, it is rotated medially through 90 degrees. So there is a rotated medial rotation of it through 90 degrees, like this. If there is a medial rotation of the first metacarpal, then the dorsal surface of the shaft will rotate from dorsal side to the lateral side. Clear? So the dorsal aspect of first metacarpal bone is facing laterally. So this is the actual dorsal surface. Due to the medial rotation, it is facing laterally. See the dorsal surface of the other metacarpals. This is the dorsal surface of other metacarpal shafts. So dorsal surface facing laterally due to a medial rotation of its shaft. That is another point. Next is that the base of the first metacarpal, the base of the first metacarpal is convexo-concave, like this, and it articulate with the reciprocally curved articular structure of trapezium to form the first carpometacarpal joint. This joint is called the first carpometacarpal joint, which is a saddle shaped synovial joint, because the articulating surfaces are convexo-concave and reciprocally curved. So first carpo metacarpal joint is saddle shaped synovial joint. So that is another important feature. Then the base of the first metacarpal does not articulate with the base of other metacarpals. It is separate. So base of the first metacarpal is actually a separate entity. It does not articulate with the base of the other metacarpals. The base of the other metacarpals articulate between each other. Right? So these are the important peculiar feature regarding the first metacarpal bone. Next we come to the discussion of the phalangeal bones. The phalangeal bones are the bones of the digits, and there are 14 phalanges in each hand, 2 for the thumb and 3 for the rest of the medial 4 fingers. The nearest phalanges is called the proximal phalanx. The middle one is the middle phalanx, and the last one is the distal phalanx. But in case of thumb, it is only proximal phalanx and distal phalanx, two of them only. The phalangeal bones are miniature long bones, just like the metacarpals. Metacarpals are also miniature long bones. So phalangeal bones are miniature long bones. Metacarpals also fall of the category of miniature long bone. And each of the phalangeal bones have got three parts. One is the base, then head on the opposite side of the base, and in between the shaft. So what are the part? Base, head, and an intervening shaft. Clear? Each phalanx, like the metacarpals, also ossifies from two centers. One is the primary center that appear before birth. It is located in the shaft. And one is the secondary center, which appear after birth, which are present at the base. So look, the primary center and secondary center of a phalanx is similar to the appearance of primary center and secondary center of the first metacarpal. So in the first metacarpal, the primary center is in the shaft and secondary center is in the base. Same is true for all the phalanx, but in the rest of the metacarpals, the primary center, though, is in the shaft, but the secondary center is at the head. So the arrangement of the ossification centers are similar in the phalangeal bones and the first metacarpal bone only. That's why the first metacarpal bone is known as a modified phalanx, because of the similarity of arrangement of the primary and secondary centers. We get different joints in between the bones of the hand. For example, in between the proximal and distal row of the carpals, we get the intercarpal and midcarpal joint. In between the carpal and metacarpal bones, carpometacarpal joint. In between the metacarpal and phalangeal bone, metacarpophalangeal joint. In between the phalangeal bones, the interphalangeal joints. So these are the different joints that are seen in the hand. What are the joints? Midcarpal, midcarpal, carpo, metacarpal, metacarpophalangeal, interphalangeal. This is the metacarpophalangeal joint. This is the carpometacarpal joint of thumb. This is the metacarpophalangeal joint of thumb. This is the interphalangeal joint of thumb. So there are the different joints that are associated with the hand, and we will discuss it later.